Back in 1993, five lads from Dublin were brought together, and little did they know what was to come for them and how Boyzone would become bigger than anything that they could ever possibly imagine.
The love affair between the fans and Ronan, Shane, Stephen, Mikey and Keith was born and would last for the next 27 years and beyond.
Boyzone, thank you for the memories podcast with Claire and Chris. Now, this episode of the podcast is slightly different. It's more of a documentary feel to it. It's from a fan's perspective. Members of our Facebook group, Boyzone, thank you for the memories. Now, there's going to be a lot of laughter. Because there's some funny bits, isn't there, Claire?
There is, definitely.
But it can get emotional at times.
It does.
Some of the memories that people evoke from the past.
Yeah, it gives you a lump in your throat.
It does. And I can't basically say this enough, but there's going to be tears. There's going to be tears. If you're listening, there's going to be tears because it's so emotional.
Yeah.
And you've been tearful, haven't you?
Yeah, I have struggled a little bit.
And even I've been honest. A bit. I've had a lump in my throat.
Yeah.
So Hank is at the ready. This is Boyzone. Thank you for the memories. And this is the fans special. But first, what we're going to hear from Woodo. Woodo from Nottingham.
Oh, yes.
Now, Woodo has been with us since very, very early days
very early
on the Facebook group.
Yeah.
She has. And we're actually going to meet with Woodo, aren't we, for the first time in January at the rearranged Ronan gig at Birmingham, the Symphony Hall.
Yeah.
Now Woodo is actually going to Nottingham a couple of days later.
She's got a meet and greet,
but she's been very keen to come and see Ronan and us as well, which we're on and about.
Well, you want to meet up for a good drink?
Yes, exactly, because it's a Saturday night, isn't it?
Yeah, we're looking.
Ronan. And I think that's what swayed Woodo's decision.
I think so. She saw the gin, the Saturday row.
The unicorn gin.
And then, yeah, go on then.
So we're going to hear from Woodo next about her memories of Boyzone.
Hi, everybody. It's Annie here. I'm going to do a little recording of my particular special moment about Boyzone. So I'm sitting in my living room. It's not a very nice day today. It's quite cold. So I've got my Boyzone music playing in the background. I hope you can all hear it. I'm going to try my best not to sing the songs and be focused, guys. But come on, feel my pain. It's so tricky when you love Boyzone. Also, I've got my snacks at the ready and I've got my wine. I'm not an alcoholic. I know it's only 1 o'clock in the afternoon. But I thought it would be nice for lunch to have a little, you know, little buffy food and a little bit of wine and Boyzone music while I tell you my story. So for me, it's all about when you go to see Boyzone, it's about the outfit, what you're going to wear, guys. Like, what's your hair going to be like? Your nails, your makeup. So for me, on that day, I had work. So I felt like I couldn't really pay that much attention that I would like to. Like, I would just like to spend even more time looking or trying to look as good as I could anyway. But I did actually get up very early to do my hair and my makeup. I did get my hair cut the day before and my nails, But obviously, because I had work, I couldn't go after work because I had to literally go after work. I had to leave, basically. So I went with Stephanie. Stephanie's also in the group of Boyzone. Thank you for the memories. Stephanie's a dear friend of mine that I am thankful for, that I'm able to share these opportunities with her. It's very special. So thank you, Stephanie. So we went to Nottingham Arena. You get there quite early to register, and you're waiting a few hours, to be quite honest. You're thinking, is this ever going to happen? Is this real? Am I dreaming? But that's fine, because at the end of the day, it's prime opportunity for me and Steph to drink all what we can. So we did, really. But for me, I like when you're waiting around, because you get to see other Boyzone fans and talk to them and chat to them about your love for Boyzone, really. So that's really cool. Then obviously Boyzone are behind a curtain, so you're in the same room, but there's this big massive curtain. You're thinking, I'm almost nearly there. I can smell the Irish blood. And me and Steph already decided that we wanted to go on our own. We wanted that experience on our own, which I would totally respect, because I wanted that too. And we both said we was glad that we did it on our own, that we didn't do it together. So Steph went in before me. I was like, you go first, Steph. So she went in, she had an amazing experience. Then I went in afterwards, and I walked in, I said hello to Shane, Mikey, Ro, Keith, in that order. I gave them all a kiss on the cheek, because I was thinking, I'm getting my money's worth, guys. And I just wanted to get the most out of the experience that I possibly could, really. And then what I did was because Keith was at the end of the queue, of the line of the boys, I upped on his arm, and I put my arm round him with the other arm, and I says, oh, he's my favourite. And Keith looked quite smug standing there, like, yeah, I'm a favourite, sort of thing. And all the other boys just looked quite bemused. And then I'm trying to, like, remember it order, guys, because I don't want to miss any vital bits out. And then, as I said, that Keith was my favourite, Shane just cracked out this one-liner and just said, well, what happened there then? And we all started laughing. And then I'm bouncing up and down, because I'm literally so excited. I can't believe that the band that I absolutely adore are in front of my eyes. I'm literally, it's so, like, so surreal. Like, my blood is pumping so fast in my body, it's unbelievable. So I'm jumping up and down, and I'm like, it's either do this, Annie, or cry. And I didn't really want to cry. I couldn't like deal with crying in front of them. I didn't want to be that girl crying in front of them, guys. So I'm jumping up and down, like, with excitement. And Ronan just says, are you all right there? He says, do you need a wee or something? And he's like finding it so, like, really amusing, that the fact that I'm literally like a teenager jumping up like a puppy, guys. And then I brought my own Sharpie pens like an idiot, because I wanted it in silver. I wanted them to sign my CD in silver. So I got my Sharpie pens out, like the little geek that I am. And Keith just looks at me, starts laughing, and I'm like, what are you laughing at? And he said, we have got our own pens, you know. I said, yeah, but I wanted it in silver. And I start, so they all sign, he says, so Ronan's like, what do you want signing? So I got my CD out, they signed my CD, and then without even thinking, I didn't prepare to actually have a speech or anything, because to be quite honest, I did really think that I would not be able to speak. But there was something within me that I thought, like, if I don't speak to Boyzone and tell them what they mean to me, that I'd always live in regret.
That's all that matters now, no matter what. No, no matter what. No, no matter what.
No, no matter. That's all that matters. No, no matter.
We're going to hear more from Woodo a bit later on in the podcast, but next up we're going to hear from a best friend.
Marvo.
Yes, also from Nottingham.
Not far from us.
No, only down the road, I don't know, about 35, 40 minutes, something like that.
Yep.
Just down the M42.
Midlands girls.
Yes, East Midlands. I'm an East Midlander originally.
I'm a West Midlander.
I have lost my accent slightly, somewhat.
Yeah, you lot sound kind of a bit better than me, because I've got that Brummy thing and everyone hates a Brummy accent, so...
It's a bit harsh, that, isn't
You're
it?
All a bit posh compared to me.
Now, Marvo is also going to join Woodo in meeting us at the Rearrange Ronan gig in January.
Yes.
At the Birmingham Symphony Hall.
Yes.
And, of course, they're going to, as we mentioned before, they're both going 2 days later.
Meet and greets, both of them.
Meet and greets at the Nottingham, yeah. I think, concert hall.
I'm not sure.
I think it is something like that.
Yeah, something
it's
like
in
like
Nottingham
that.
Anyway.
Exactly.
Yeah, that would do, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
So we're going to hear Marvo's story next.
Hi, Claire and Chris. Here's my Boyzone memories I want to share with you for the podcast. My first memory is of Steo. I must have been about 8. For Christmas, I got 2... of their albums on cassette, and me and my cousin were both big Boyzone fans, so much so that a few weeks after Christmas I'd gone over to my gran's house and we ended up having a full-blown argument about who loves Stephen Gately the most. We ended up with tears. My grandparents were totally confused. My parents and her mum were like, why are you arguing over a boy band? They just couldn't understand. But yeah, it was our first argument. And over love of Boyzone. My other memories of Boyzone are going to the gigs with Annie. We kind of bonded over our love when she was temping at the nursery that I work at. And then we started going to the gigs together. And then last year we went to the January gig of the last tour. The meet and greet, and I was so nervous. I just was paranoid that my face was beetroot. I kept going, is my face red? Is my face red? It wasn't. I had a full face of makeup on to stop the redness. But one of the management team of Boyzone was like, no, you're fine. Then he went to ask Shane if he thought I looked red, and Shane put his hands on my cheeks and said, no, you're fine. Come and join us. So I had photos taken, then Ronan noticed my T-shirt, as me and Annie had got matching T-shirts for the gig. And it's like, oh, where'd you get your T-shirt from? It's not one of the official ones. I was like, no, it's from Primark. He was like, ah, that's JC Penney's. I started singing this JC Penney jingle with Mikey. I wasn't quite sure what JC Penney's was really. I had to Google it afterwards, but I was just stood there like in amazement that I was meeting them and that they were singing to me. My next memories are of going to London with Annie, and we got a hotel. We'd been doing makeup and getting ready for the gig whilst listening to the boys on Spotify, and we had a few drinks, and then we got down there for the gig. And he managed to be able to ask him a question. I was just so nervous and just couldn't. And then during the gig, I was, both of us really, were just so emotional. Just like, it's the last ever one. And yeah, we were both in tears for most of the gig really. But yeah, it was fantastic seeing them and We're going to go see Ronan in January and seeing Boys Life in May. So I can't wait to see them, get more memories of the boys doing their own things. So I hope you like my memories. And I can't wait to hear the podcast. Bye.
Up next, we spoke to Janko, Janko from Ellesmere Port in Liverpool.
Ah, Janko.
We'll go into that a bit more when we speak to her.
Yes.
We spoke to her a few days back, and Janko has been, she's a founder member of the Facebook group, Boyzone Thankyou for the Memories. Yep, she's been there since day one.
Yes.
And, we're very proud to have as a founder member.
I'll always remember Janko for one thing.
What's that?
The first day that the group started, she messaged me on the night.
Oh, yeah.
She had a few problems.
Oh, God,
her settings weren't allowing her to see things and respond to comments and things.
Okay.
She messaged me, she's a bit confused.
Oh, dear, bless.
No, she could shut up.
What?
Where are you taking
me? I'm not taking the mic. Oh, come on, carry
but
on then.
Anyway,
spit it out.
There was a bit of a problem.
Okay.
And I always remember from that, because that's when I first spoke to Janko.
Mm-hmm.
And as it turned out, Janko and I, we're good friends now, and we speak about things nothing to do with Boyzone at all.
Yeah, stuttering with Boyzone, you do, but other stuff as
well. Yeah, as well.
Normal.
Yeah, that's what I mean. A normal thing. Family, work, life, life's a load of crap.
Not that Boyzone's abnormal.
No, of course not.
You know, I know what you mean. I'm taking the piss here. Of course I'm taking the piss.
And we're going to meet up with Janko, aren't we?
We are.
And a lovely hubby.
And a husband, Ian.
Ian, yeah.
Okay. I'll give his name away. Meant to speak of our nicknames.
Well, I don't think he's going to be listening to you.
I hope not.
The only thing he did be is you can take the flak for this one.
So, yes, Janko is up next. Let's hear from Janko when we spoke to her a short while ago. John Lennon, Ringo Starr, Paul McCartney, George Harrison, Eric Acora, Keith Chegwin. They're all spouses. And we've got Janko. We've got Janko on the line, but she's not a proper scouser.
No, no.
But, Sweet Paul, which is up there, mate.
Ken Dodd.
Ken Dodd. Ooh, nutty ash. Sorry, Keith.
Keith Chegwin.
Good evening, Janko. How are you?
I'm all right, thanks. Keith Chegwin. Is he even from Liverpool?
I hope so.
You better pay.
I hope so.
It's been a big
So Janko, you're on. You're going to talk to us about some of your very memorable Boyzone moments from over the years, special moments that
memories
mean a lot to you.
Yes.
So please tell us all about some of your Boyzone moments.
Right. Which one do you want me to start off with?
You start wherever you want to.
Right, I'll start off from the very beginning then. So the 96 World Tour, basically a Sky School for the day. On the 29th of April, my mum rang in sick and told them that I had a bad throat, which wasn't wrong the day after because I got tonsillitis after the concert.
Tonsillitis.
So basically that day, skived off, went to Wales with my mum, my brother-in-law, my sister. Because my sister was coming into the concert with me. My mum just wanted to tag along. first tour I'd ever been to see the lads. My sister, treated me to everything, bless her. And she bought me, loads of merchandise, including me T-shirt, which I'll get into later. And we got to sit in the Royal Box. So in the old Rill Pavilion, there used to be, a little Royal Box at the side of the stage. That was where it got really interesting because I got to wave at Ronan with a chicken drumstick. my mum being my mum and obviously not wanting us to starve to death, thinking, we're going to starve and freeze even though it's April, packed a picnic as usual. And I'd stood outside and it was probably me, my sister, my brother-in-law, he didn't want to be there, my mum, and a few other fans stood by the gates. And as quick as like we were stood there, a van come flying out just as my mum put a chicken drumstick in my hand. And all I remember seeing Ronan's face in front of me in the van, and I just waved at him with the chicken drumstick, and he just burst out laughing. And I threw my chicken drumstick in the air as the van went past. My sister was on the opposite side. She waved at Shane, fell over the wall, fell on her ass. Sorry, I mean, I just swear.
Yeah.
Over the wall. And my mum just started laughing. And then the van just went flying past us down the road, doing about 90 miles an hour. And then that night, my mum decided to scale the wall. So when me and my sister went into the concert later on, my mum decided to go around the back with my brother-in-law and scaled a 6-foot wall. And she's only small as well, bless her. And she kept shouting for Ronan to come to the window. And he never did. So she shouted for Shane, because she used to fancy Shane. She still does. She fancies a bit of Shano. So she was Shane, come to the window. She got told off by Barry Knight to get down, to which she went,
Baz.
Yeah.
Nah, I'm not getting down. So she defied him, told him off. And then Shane came to the window and waved. And I did have that on a VHS. Don't know if I've still got it anywhere, but I had that on camcorder.
Brilliant.
And then when I went into the concert, cut long story short, I was in the little royal box at the side of the stage. So it was back in the day with the tinfoil, you know, coat and trousers and together, which is our favourite song.
It is.
Oh, and it was ace. And I think I cried and I cried. But I could actually see them behind the stage getting dressed behind the curtain. Didn't see anything, unfortunately.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yeah. It was a bit inappropriate. I was a teenager as well. But anyway, I just remember sort of like, you know, looking at Ronan adoringly, like, oh, like going, there was about 1,000 people. I waited till it went really quiet and I screamed and he just looked up at me. I'll always remember it. And sort of like give me this little grin. And then Theo and Shane were behind the curtain waving at us, waving at me and my sister. So that was the best night. Because I screamed that much, I actually got like tonsillitis, laryngitis, wherever it was. And I couldn't eat for the rest of the school.
Oh, that's amazing.
Oh, that's turned out that my mum wasn't lying, because I did have a bad throat. Because I'd been to the concert. That was the first time.
Okay.
Many, many years later, December 2018, I got to meet Shane. Unexpectedly, literally, last minute win, went to see Bohemian Rhapsody, another film. Great film. Went to the Cheshire Oaks cinema.
Right.
It was a wet and windy night. I was a bit windswept. I had no makeup on, the works. So I looked a tramp. Went to the cinema. And I was stood in the queue with my daughter, just chatting, waiting to go in. And I heard the woman in front of me say, "Is that him out of Boyzone?" So I'm looking round. Oh, yeah, this is the first time I met Shane. You've probably seen the awful picture of me on my Facebook. So I just looked at her and I was going, was she on about Boyzone? And next to where we were stood, there was a massive screen. So I thought Boyzone were on the screen. So I was like, dead confused, right? Dead easily confused because I'm a bit dozy. I was looking.
Yeah, but I bet your Boyzone antenna was working a treat, wasn't it?
Because I was going, where's Boyzone on the telly? What's she on about? And I heard her saying something to her husband, going, you know, the one with the tattoos on his neck. And I'm going, what's Shane? So I'm still looking round. And in the end, I just sort of poked her in the back. And I went, excuse me. I went, did you just say something about Boyzone? And she went, yeah, he's just gone past. Well, that was it. I dropped my popcorn on the floor. My daughter was mortified. I turned around and seen Shane in his cap, his little grey cap with his long, and not being horrible, but it did look a little bit greasy hair, right? But he was walking out.
He wasn't the best deck. Was it?
And there was a massive queue behind me. I'll be honest, I didn't care. I just pushed them all out the way. I was like,
really?
Get out the way. It's Shane. My daughter was stood there with a mouth open, just mortified. And I went running after him. flung the door open behind him and just sort of grabbed him on the shoulder and went and tapped him like must have looked like a mad woman, honest to God. He turned round and looked frightened. I'm so sorry. And I went, I've been a massive fan. I said, from day one, can I get a picture? And he just burst out laughing in my face, which I thought was quite inappropriate. Sheena had walked off with the kids and I could see her. And I thought,
all right.
I'm so sorry. I know you're with your family. I'd never ask it, but I've never, ever met any of you. And he was like, yeah, sure. Now, the funny part to this is, he said something to me and I couldn't understand him.
Okay.
So I just went, eh? Like that in his face. And he went, he said it again, but I couldn't understand him because I was a bit deaf because this is in December and I was going in for an operation on my ear in January.
Right.
So I was half deaf. So I just said, yeah, I'm coming to see you. I said, in January, the concert. And he went, no, what are you here to see tonight? And I went, Bohemian Rhapsody. I started laughing. So that was it. So he must have thought, oh, God, you're a moron.
Go on. Janka, was he seeing Bohemian Rhapsody 2? Was he in the same film as you, in the same, theatre or whatever?
No, he was with his kids. He'd come out of one of the cinemas when I was going in. I don't know what he'd been to say. I didn't even ask him, to be honest. It was a bit rude.
Couldn't he?
So Shannon must live near you then?
He lives about 20 minutes away from me. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I know where he lives without giving it away. But
right. Yeah, of course.
So you've stalked outside his house, I take it.
No, I know where he lives because I've got one of his friends on Instagram and stuff like that, and he does speak. And obviously, he's got his bar that he is opening in Chester, which is not a secret. Everyone knows he's opening a bar in Chester. But yeah, Shane lives is literally about 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes away from me. So he's not too far up the road. So that's why, I can sort of go past where his sister's got the hairdresser and his favourite little Cheshire restaurant and stuff. It's literally down the road from here.
Oh, people are going to be jealous about this.
They are. There are going to be a few jealousies.
Yeah.
he actually goes a lot as well. Know if you've seen him on Instagram with Sheena and B&Q. That's the B&Q that is literally around the corner from my works. And every time I've seen him on it and I've been in work on that day, my boss does near the end of it that he was round the corner and I've been sat there. So, when I say round the corner, I mean 5 minutes away from where I work. So I'm there going, I shouldn't be working. I should be seeing Shane and B&Q.
Of course you would. I tried to think what happened. The boys that live 20 minutes away from us.
Oh, God.
Nightmare for you. That's brilliant.
I basically got him to take the picture and I look awful on it, but he was lovely and I didn't give him a hug because I felt a bit awkward. I should have asked for one.
Yeah.
And then, sorry, I'm probably yapping on too much.
No, this is amazing.
This is brilliant.
The time I actually got to meet them that cost me 300 quid.
Ouch.
Ouchie.
Worth it, but it's bloody expensive.
It is.
You know what? Because I knew it was the last tour, I didn't mind paying it so much because I never ever had the chance and I was determined to do it after... I'd had such a crappy year. I thought, no, do you know what? I work hard. I'm going to buy it. Ian didn't have a choice. I just bought it. I didn't pay my car that month.
I don't blame you.
So I met them on October the 19th. And that was in Manchester.
Roger.
Or whatever it's called now. And basically, the week before, I'd had some idiot, without swearing, reverse into me, so I had a bit of whiplash. So I was a bit off my face. It's not going down well. So every time I've met them, something's happened. I've got to redeem myself because I'm determined to buy a Ronan meet and greet, and I'm going to redeem myself so he doesn't think I'm stupid. But when I met them in October. God, you couldn't make it up. When I met them in October, I was on diazepam for the pain because I was in a lot of pain still.
You were high as a kite.
Yeah.
Basically, yeah. So I booked into this hotel that was something like out of American Horror Story. That's all I can describe as. The fire alarm kept going off. I was getting chucked out into the street every 2 minutes. I was like, oh God, I just want to get a drink before I go and blah, blah. I was on my own. So I wanted to calm my nerves. I thought, I know, I'll have a little bit of gin. But I'd had my diazepam beforehand and I forgot. So I had a gin, a big fishbowl thing of gin. And by the time that I'd gone from the hotel to the MEN, I was a little bit off my face. So I stood in the queue and I was chat to everyone and I was loving life and I was like, oh, this is amazing. I'm going to meet Boyzone. I wasn't even nervous. Mm-hmm. Got to the, like I said, to the venue and stuff. And when we were queuing to go in, I was sort of like pushing my way to the front because I was like, I'm going to be one of the first to meet them. So I was like, got my way to the front. And then when we were due to go in, we put our bags on the side. They would like be in front of like a, do you know, like a blue screen kind of thing. And I could see Shane's arm sticking out. So I was getting excited because I could see his arm. I could see and sort of hear Keith because I kept seeing him bobbing out and I was getting really excited. Then we come round the back and then I kept sort of sticking my head round. So I was like next and I stuck my head round. I just seen Ronan and went, whoop, dead loud. And I kept laughing. I kept sort of like doing this like little bobbing thing, looking around the corner, and he spotted me and looked at me like I was some kind of mental. And I think he was just laughing because I kept going, oh, like that to the girl behind me. I was going, oh, it's Ronan. So I'd give me t-shirt ahead, which is the one that I had from 1996, that tour that I was just on about before.
Yeah.
I gave me t-shirt and I said, right, that's what I want signed. I had my card ready for them. I'd made for them and everything. I'd got done on that moon pig thing.
Yeah, of course, I remember that.
And I'd basically put, it was quite personal, to be honest, but I'll give you a little bit of it. But it was just saying sort of like, I'd gone through a horrible time, like back in 2000, where I had a major op and nearly never pulled through, basically. And then I got married and stuff because I had to put all my wedding off and everything, blah, blah, blah. And that's why I got married to Boyzone and everything else. So I put it all in there and put how much they meant to me, like every other fan would. And I had this card and I said to one of the guys, I said, can I give it to them? And he was like, yeah, it's fine. Because I thought they were going to try and take it off me. But because I was a bit high as a kite on pills and drink, I thought they're not taking it off me. I was like, I'm asking out of kindness, but I am giving it them. Kind of attitude. So after me poking my head round anyway, Ronan thinking I was a weirdo, I finally come round the corner and I just went, I don't care if you say I can't give him a hug, I'm giving him a hug like that. And I went 26, and I shouldn't swear, but bastard years I've waited for this.
I don't blame you.
The Oxman, I grabbed him. He was absolutely hysterical. He was like, oh my God, I can't believe you just said that. I give him a hug. Ronan looked frightened and he was tiny. And I give him a hug. Mikey was laughing.
What do you mean he was tiny?
Oh, he was little. He was so small.
Small.
He needed a beef dinner. He needed like a bit of my trifle.
Oh,
he was little. He's really small, honestly. He was tiny. He's still really nice looking, like crikey, you know. But yeah, he was really small. My first impression of Keith was, wow, you're so better looking in real life.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, it's the teeth, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's the gnashes.
And the muscles.
Yeah. Oh, he's gorgeous. He's really nice. And them teeth, amazing.
They're on his own.
What about Shano?
Oh, he's lovely. Well, I'd hugged Keith. He was in hysterics because I was just like, meh. I'd hugged Ronan. I think he was grateful that I'd sort of moved on from him. And then I give Mikey a hug. And Mikey was really lovely. He was so humble. He was so
humble. Yeah,
and then I come to Shane and I went, all right, Shane. He just looked at me and I went, I met you outside the cinema, I said, last year. And I went,
did you smell him? No, did you smell? Shane smells amazing. Oh, yeah,
I didn't sniff him myself.
But... he smells lovely, doesn't he?
He's gorgeous. I must admit, over the years, Shane's really grew on me a lot more. But,
yes.
Yeah.
Exactly the same. But he does bloody smell good, though. You got to love a man that smells good.
Is this a cologne smell?
They all did. They all had their own smell. They really did. I know it sounds stupid, but they did. And Shane was just lovely. And when I said to him, I'd already met him outside Cheshire Oak Cinema, he looked at me a bit confused, but a bit like thinking.
Yes, I can imagine.
And I went, I have blonde hair then. I've got brown hair now. I bet he thought, what the hell?
Oh, this is fantastic. Fantastic
literally
stuff.
Literally, I gave him
the card and I said, that's for you all. And then I went, hang on a minute, I'm getting in the middle. And they were all just giggling, like proper giggling. And then I got in the middle of them and I grabbed Mikey and I grabbed Ronan and literally squeezed them and pulled them in. And then I got a picture. Wow. But honest to God, I have never been so off my face when I met them. So I think I do have to redeem myself if I meet Ronan and go in a bit more normal.
But did you like the picture, though?
No, I ate it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
No, you don't like it. I think it's a lovely photo. Oh,
bless.
Well, at least you can remember, even though you're off your head.
Yeah, I was like...
Yeah. Off your head. On drink and drugs. Legal drugs. Hang on. Legal drugs. Yes, don't worry. Legal drugs. It's good that you still remember, because it would have been a shame if you'd done all that and not remembered.
Yeah.
It looked like I was a little bit tipsy, but to be honest, it helped with the nerves, because I thought I was going to cry, but I didn't. I had the biggest smile on my face. And I'd say to anyone that can do it, it's worth every penny. And it's just such a shame that we might not be able to do it again with them all. I'm hoping that they do.
Well, you never know. You never know. Thank you, Jenko, for joining us. Your stories are fantastic.
We could listen to you all night.
Yeah, it's only all stories, but we will be speaking to other people and hearing their stories as well. But that was absolutely brilliant.
Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you.
Bye.
You take care.
Take care. Bye.
Next up, we've got a story, stroke memory, from Kirko. Now, Kirko's a lovely lady who's a member of our group. But Claire is actually going to read this, as Kirko asked us to read a story for her. She didn't want to speak, did she?
No, she didn't.
But which is fine.
Oh, of course.
Not everyone wants to speak, but...
Oh, God, no.
But people did want to share their memories, like Kirko has.
Yeah.
Now, Kirko's memory involves a book that she got signed by the boys at a meet and greet last year. We've seen the photo of it, and it's so really, really special.
It's lovely.
On this photo, there's a page that she had signed, and on this page, there's a picture of her mum.
Yeah.
And mam.
Yeah.
And Claire is going to read Kirko's story now.
Yep, this is Kirko's story. My meet and greet was my very first one. My mum was a big fan of Stephen. She died in 2004 and I started going to concerts after I lost her. When I went in with my book, Shane signed it first. He asked who the lady was. I explained and I told him that I had lost a part of her again when Stephen had died. Mikey then went over to Shane and said about the picture of my mum. Oh, what a lovely looking lady. I can see the resemblance. Keith then shouts over, come here, I'm going to give you a hug. Mikey then came over and put his arm around me and I had my photo taken. Some folk might think that my memory is stupid, but when Stephen died, I did lose a part of my mum. And it was at that time that I came onto Facebook and met some really lovely people and have become good friends. On the 10th of October 2009, our love affair with the boys came to a massive, unexpected pause. We all woke up to the news that we'd lost our beloved sister. Excuse me. I always knew it was going to be hard, but I'll do it. It was so unexpected, and I think we were all in a massive shock for a long, long time. And I think those images that we saw when the boys flew out there to bring him home at the airport probably all stay with us forever. And one of the main reasons why I put my heart and soul into doing this group is because not only do I love the boys, all of them, but because of Steo. Because through Boyzone, Steo will always live on. His memory will always be kept alive. And we will never forget him. We miss him so much. They are always, always five. And I don't think any of us have ever recovered after that fateful day. But we are strong. We look after each other. We've all looked after each other, the boys, and it's united us, and it's special. Boys are not something special. We're not just your average fans. We're special because we've lived through this, and the boys, and we're all united. And Steo, we miss you every day, but you're always, always in our hearts.
Next, we're going to hear from Nicola Denno Dennigan from London, the capital of England.
Yep.
Now, Denno has been a member of our Facebook group for since the very early days.
Yep.
But with regard to the Denno nickname, we tried to give each member of our group a nickname ending with an O.
Yeah,
so,
we do.
So, like, we've had Jenka, we've had Wooda, we've had Marvo, Kirko, Como, yep. People that have, you know, we speak to. Sorry if I've missed anyone then. Apologies.
It's a bit of fun, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a bit of fun. So, yeah, we try to give them it. Sometimes it could be hard work because it doesn't always work with an O
no.
on here, but we manage to do
we
it, don't
to
we?
Do it, yeah.
So, Denno has been to lots and lots of Boyzone shows over the years. So, now we're going to hear from Denno a lovely story from a lovely lady.
This is the story of when I met Boyzone at HMV for their very last album signing. What happened was I saw on one of the Facebook groups that Boyzone were going to be doing an album signing and you were supposed to get wristbands if you pre-ordered the album. I thought I had no chance, so basically I went on to HMV's thing and I put my details and luckily there was still some in. So I pre-ordered the album and got the tickets. Then one of my friends asked if she could do the same. We had a bit of trouble with that and then managed to get it all sorted. Well, on the day of the signing, I went up to sing, which is a big thing for me as I suffer from agoraphobia. When I got to the HMV, typical, it was raining. So I went inside, I had to go up to the first floor, and I said to the bloke that I'm here to get my wristband for the Boyzone signing. And they said, what's your name? I went, Nicola Dennigan. And they said, it's not there. I thought, oh no, I'm not going to meet him. So I said, oh, I got the email. He says, I can't find it. But luckily, there's a few people on the list that for some reason the payment hadn't gone through, and mine was one of them. Lucky I brought some money with me, and I managed to get my wristband. I walk with the walking stick. It's just for helping me walk around. And the security guard was lovely, and he said, right, you and your friend, as you're disabled, come and sit down. And they got us chairs, and I'll take you up in the lift, clothing. So we sort of bypassed the queue, because we've had to queue outside. So we went upstairs, and there was a long queue. You could see the boys sitting at the table. And then we sat on the chairs, and I could see Ronan signing. He was chatting to each one. I was getting very nervous, and I also had like a book of messages for the band. So basically, we had to wait there for maybe 5 minutes, and then they called us over. And some people looked at us sort of in a strange way because we bypassed the queue. And the first person that I met was Keith, and he said, how are you? I said, I'm fine, squeaky like a mouse. And I gave him a book, and I said, this is from the fans, all different messages say thank you. And he said, oh, I'm going to read that, and he put it down inside it. Next, it was Mikey, or was it Shane, I can't remember. And he said hello, and I got my picture. And if you ask them nicely, they were having their photographs with you. You couldn't go around behind the table. They sort of lean forward and have your photograph with them. And then it was Shane, who had his black cap on, and he was lovely. And then last of all was Ronan, and I said, thank you so much for everything, and also doing magic. And he says, oh, do you listen? I went, yeah. He said, oh, he said, thank you so much, and he signed. And then I went back to put my chair and to leave the signing. I was gutted that it was all over, but it was definitely worth it. And my friend couldn't stop thinking, and we kept looking at our phones thinking, I can't believe it, after 25 years, or we've actually finally met the boys. I wish they were still around, but I still listen to their music every single day. Okay, that's my story. I hope you enjoy it. Bye! What I forgot to say was that the HMV that was in the album sign is now closed down, which is very sad. Okay, this is the end of it. Okay, bye!
Miss your smile, miss the moments we were wild. We will always be in my heart. Couldn't hold it when you left. You took the melody. It's not our choice, but it still feels wrong. Just not a song. Cause you make it real, and it gets hard to feel. If you can only come back, come back. I will give anything, just wanna hear you sing. If you can only come back, come back for one more song. For one more song. You're a friend, and you'll always be, and a place I'll forever keep. When I'm down, I look up to the sky, so you can lift me up, you can lift me up. It's not a choice, it's not a choice, but it still feels wrong. But I feel so wrong without you. It's just not a song. It's just not.
right to feel if you can only come back.
Mrs. Melody.